All right. Welcome back. Third session, last session, then we have Q&A time after another break. So I'm going to keep talking here until I see people starting going comatose, and then we'll see what happens. But my notes here say at the top, start with Jesus. Well, that's not, you know, it's like, why did I need to remind myself that? Maybe we just do. I've been, as I said before, teaching in the area of mission for a long time. And one of the most difficult things to account for, or embarrassing things as a missiologist, is trying to explain what Jesus' own mission strategy was. Because actually, it doesn't really appear that he had one. Which is a real problem for people that want to be big on mission strategy and everything, especially if you want to start with Jesus. If he didn't have a strategy, however, we might say that he had a manifesto. And John's Gospel is quite helpful in that regard. You know, in various places and in various ways, Jesus says, I only do what I see the Father doing. And I only say what I hear the Father saying. You're familiar with those passages, right? So my question is this. What did Jesus see? I only do what I see the Father doing. What did he hear? I only do what I hear the Father saying. I'm appealing to your imagination again, right? So Jesus is walking around. What is he seeing that lies behind his mission? I'm just curious. I hadn't planned on asking this question, but what comes to your mind? What do you think Jesus sees when he says those things?
I have a direct story related to it, about Jesus. He spit on the ground and made some blood and put it into a man's eyes.
Yeah.
I thought that was the most nastiest, disgusting thing I've ever heard.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I guess I was like, okay, well, I guess that's kind of what he heard it, or at least was told to do, or I guess seen God do it.
Yeah.
That's the first thing he's going to say.
Yeah. Yeah, so what if as Jesus is walking around, he sees a blind man, you know, and enters the conversation. He sees a blind man, but actually what he also sees is the Father spitting on the ground, making a paste and putting on. So what does he do? He spits on the ground, makes paste, puts on the eyes. What else comes to mind? I only do what I see the Father do.
Would that be where the Holy Spirit comes in?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Say a little bit more.
That he really reveals what he should be doing.
Right.
What the Father wants him to do.
Right, right. So the Spirit, we could say the Spirit, you know, reveals to him in those situations, you know, his spiritual eyes, you know, he sees this, and so he knows what he needs to do, because it's the kind of thing that the Father would do. What would the Father do when he sees somebody blind? You know, he'll make a salve. Come back to a conversation we had earlier about Amish salve making. But anyway, you can talk to them about. Sorry, should never use in jokes. I'm sorry, bad form. But anyway, yeah, no, he and puts it on his eyes. The Father wants this guy to see, right? Well, you know, you could multiply the examples. I mean, you could work it backwards. What do you see Jesus doing that then becomes a revelation of what the Father is doing? Do you see? Look at it the other way around. So what does Jesus do? So he sees a leper. And let's work it backwards. So what Jesus sees is the Father putting his hand on the leper and praying for that leper to be healed. So what does he do? He goes to the leper and, you know, he's not thinking, what am I going to catch? What's going to, you know, he knows that this is what the Father's heart is for this leper. And he puts his hand on the leper and prays for the leper to be healed. You could multiply the examples, couldn't you? You know. In Matthew 14, I think it's 14:14, but there's a number of examples where the scripture sort of depicts it like this. I think in that verse it says something like, you know, Jesus saw the crowd and had compassion on them and then healed the sick. Right? He saw something. He had, and that seeing, you know, maybe he's seeing, you know, what the Father's heart for those sick people, you know. What is the Father doing in his kingdom? The Father is healing people in his kingdom, and he sees these people caught up in kingdom reality and is going to bring the kingdom near to them, right? In the kingdom there is no blindness, sickness, tears, you know, anymore, all of that. And then it says he had compassion. You know, there's some interesting Greek there. That word, the word compassion there, it really translates, you know, it comes from the word for guts, you know, bowels. It's about being motivated, you know, a gut instinct, a pull, a desire to do something. It's not just not just empathy. You know, there's a moving power within you. Like maybe this is the connection again to the Holy Spirit, right? There's a, oh gosh, just lost it. I was going to say, there's a sort of bowel movement, but I didn't mean that. This is too soon to lunch, something like that. But why didn't I just keep my mouth shut? I don't know, it just came out. You know, he's moved. That's what I'm looking for. He is moved in his inner being, right? He is moved. And he goes and lays. And then we're told, so he saw, and then he went and healed, you know. That pattern of seeing, of sensing the impulse and the movements of the Spirit within and being moved to do something and going and doing something, putting his hands on them. What if that is what mission essentially is? It wouldn't, you know, we might have our projects and programs and outreaches and all the rest of it. But are we the kind of people that see and are moved and then do and get caught up, you know, in God's missional movement in that moment with those people? Jesus did not seem to have a mission strategy unless it is blessing the lives of everybody he met along the way. Now, which is what he did. Which seems to me to be a pretty decent mission strategy. It's a little bit different than some of the ways we might think about that, about planning, etc. I want to just unpack some of those thoughts to go back to our small group thing. They're not packed away for a very good reason. You know, they need to be unpacked. I want to think about those things a little, each of those things a little deeper. But really, what I want to say is what it in the Wesleyan tradition, I think what the kind of missional dynamic is about. It's not about specific projects or special people doing those things. It's about what it means, as I said before, for disciples to be missionary by their very nature. That's kind of what I was trying to get at in the first session. That, you know, if we are being filled and transformed and overflowing with the Holy Spirit, we will be both recipients and participants in what God is doing. Let's just simply call it, you know, we are growing in love of God and neighbor. And, you know, we're caught up in that flow. And it's wherever we are every day, 24/7. That's, you know, we are called to be ordinary missionaries. All of us are sent, you know, into our daily lives to amongst the people that God puts in our way to bless and minister to. You know, that's the basic idea, being everyday missionaries. Now, what is the church? Let's have a slogan. A body of believers. We are the church, right? Well, we say that, and I hope we believe that. Where is the church?
Everywhere.
Everywhere, right? Sometimes the church gathers, right? This would be an expression of church right here, you know, a gathering of believers together. And then what happens when we have finished here? We scatter, right? Now, you all might not be scattering too far, though I'm going back to England, you know, but we all go to different places. And the church exists in those two modes, you know, when we gather and when we scatter. So, we're in Kansas still. So, we gather and we scatter, and we're blown by the wind to the four corners. I'm getting all cheesy now. I've got images of those sort of dandelion things blown about. So we gather and we scatter. Where are we most of the time? Gathered or scattered?
Scattered.
How much of most of the time? What percentage of the time? Huh? Most of the time. We spend the vast majority, the church spends the vast majority of time in its mode as scattered missionaries in the world. And yet when we think about where we actually invest often, you know, in our leadership and ministry, it is in the gathered, which may not be a problem. If, when we gather, what we are doing is preparing ourselves to be scattered. If, however, our gathering becomes an end in itself, which is one of the problems, you know, with institutionalized forms of being the church, then it really becomes an exercise of missing the point. I mean, actually, the church, when it gathers, is meant to be a mission society, you know, that comes to celebrate what God's doing 24/7 in our lives and through our lives with other people, and that's what our worship is meant to be about. And then we are equipped in various ways as we gather together to go and live that out and come back again. And, you know, there's that rhythm of gathering and scattering. What I want to do just in this session is think a little bit about especially how these very small groups that I call band meetings and the spiritual conversation that we have with one another, which is a form of gathering, one of the ways that we gather, equips us for that being scattered, if that makes sense. And what I want to do to trace that through is take each of those four dimensions of discipleship, you know, that I outlined before at the beginning, those four there. Okay, so the first one, seeking growth. So the question then is, how do we become recipients and participants, you know, in God's mission? Let me just backtrack a little bit and talk about Wesley's theology of salvation. So, you know, this was maybe familiar territory to you, I don't know. But I want to explain it in this way. It's one of my favorite images comes from Saint Irenaeus from the early church. He spoke about God, the Father, having two hands, right? God the Father on the one hand is God the Son, and the other hand is God the Holy Spirit, right? You see this Trinitarian image. Now, what Saint Irenaeus, where did he put? He speaks of this God saving us is like this. On the one hand, God sends His Son into the world, right? He sends His Son to live our life, to die our death, to be raised from the dead, to take our sin upon Himself, and then to return to the Father. He sends His Son, in other words, Skittles. I'm gonna just pick that one up, because that one the enemy is gonna use for my undoing. I can tell. So God sends his son into the world, in other words, to make a way for us. You know, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Make a way for us to the Father. Okay, he comes so that. And then on the other hand, God sends the Holy Spirit into the world and into our hearts to do what? To bring us into that way, so that we might travel that way. In the first instance, that Spirit, when the Spirit brings us into that way, brings us into a relationship with the Father and enables us to have the same relationship with the Father that Jesus himself had, so that by that Spirit, our hearts cry out, Abba, Father. And then that same Spirit, in that way, begins to transform us into the likeness of Jesus, you know, until one day we die and, you know, we are raised to new life and brought completely into the Father's presence, you know, in the new creation. See? That same Spirit brings us into relationship with the Father, secures our identity as his beloved children, fills us with his Spirit, changes us into his likeness. So on the one hand is what God does. Wesley puts it this way: what God does for us in Jesus to forgive us of our sins, on the other hand, is what the Holy Spirit does in us to transform us into the likeness of Jesus from the inside out, and we enter into this divine embrace. We are embraced by God. That's what salvation is. Dr. Bruns, can I make an example of you? I mean, use you as an example. Please come forward. I think you might have a clue as to what I'm going to do here now. Don't think too hard about it. So, okay. Sinner. You know what I'm talking about, right? Don't look at me. Turn around. Disgusting. God, okay. Just for illustration purposes, okay. So, yeah, you can keep going. I'm telling you. Okay, sinner, God, sinner. Dr. Bruns, can I call you Steve?
Yeah.
Okay. Don't look at me. So, you are disgusting in my eyes. You are a 5'10" worm. And you know what? You are there's no way that we can hang out together, but here's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna send my son Jesus to die for you. And then be raised for you. And then so long as you put your trust in him and believe in him, then when I look at you, what I can do is see Jesus and not have to look upon your sorry being. And then we'll be okay together until you die. So long as you keep believing in Jesus and keep asking for that forgiveness, you know, then we'll be okay. And then when you die, well, you know, then we'll be good, okay? Is that a deal?
Sure.
Okay.
So I don't have to do anything else.
Repent and believe, maybe, but that's it. So, okay, right. So, gospel version number one. Familiar with this gospel? It's one that I learned to start with and learned to preach about. But you know what? This isn't the gospel that Wesley taught or St. Irenaeus. And it is only actually, at best, half the gospel, not the whole gospel. This is more like what the whole gospel is like. Okay. Steve, you are a 5'10" worm. Some things don't change. Okay, that's the basic bottom line. Okay. But here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to send my son to live for you, live your life and die for you and forgive you of your sins. Okay? Is that okay?
Yes.
And okay, so now you can turn it. Now, here is what it looks like, Steve, for me to do that. Nope, wait.
Yep.
We could be a long time here, folks. Thank you, my delightful assistant, for your example. Forgiveness is not just God declaring us right across a gap. It is about intimacy. The same that Jesus had. It's about entering into that same relationship that Jesus had with the Father. And here's the thing. When you are embraced by God, you are drawn near to Him. You know, you're drawn near to Him. When you are drawn near like that, you are changed. You cannot stay the same because as He draws you, He breathes His Spirit into you, imparts His Spirit into you, and His Spirit changes, you know, you. So, you know, let's call it becoming one with God, you know, relation, justification. Let's call the whole embrace and the breathing of the Spirit and the transformation sanctification, if you like, you know. The other early church fathers took that image of embrace and talked about salvation in terms of and the Trinity actually and our involvement in terms of a dance, right? Now, my mother tried to teach me how to dance when I was a teenager. You know, ballroom dance. It's all the rage now in England, is it? Has it caught on here? Strictly Come Dancing and everything? No? Wow, it's a big thing in England now. I don't get it, but you know, anyway, it's there. So my mother, you know, she watched, for some reason she thought I ought to learn this social skill. So she got hold of me and she drew me in like this and said, now you just follow my feet, you know. And you can see she failed. So, I can remember the... As we're doing this, I'm following her, you know, of course, what do I end up doing? Standing on her feet, and she goes, ah, get away from me, you wretched child. I have the scars to... No, I didn't. She did wince quite a bit. But then she said, no, come on. Let's do that again. Takes me back. Keep the dance going. The goal was that over time, I would become a dancer. It's not her fault that it failed. But what it left with me, I probably was even more important than being able to dance, which was a brilliant image of our life with God. You know, we tread on His toes over and over again. The goal is not just to be forgiven from a distance, not just to be put right, not just, you know, to be declared not guilty, not just to be given a card, you know, for heaven when we die. The goal is to be drawn close and to dance with God through life, to be filled with His Spirit and turned into His likeness and learn how to live and walk and work with Him. We often focus on the forgiveness. We don't often get the whole growing and sanctification bit right. And there's a piece that's even more largely missing than that, I discover, as I travel churches all over, not just Methodist churches, but, you know, Baptist churches, Pentecostal churches, charismatic house churches. And it's this. There's a terrible lack of understanding of the gifts of the Spirit. If I stop and ask, even people in ministry, tell me, what are your spiritual gifts? They'll scratch their head and can't tell me. Now, maybe you're all better because you've all been taught about this stuff. But, you know, it's one thing, God embraces us. It's what God does for us and what God does in us to change us into the likeness of Jesus. But it's also then the dance. It's what God does with us. And, you know, and our part that we play looks different depending upon the gifts that God gives us and the nature of the dance. Not all dances are the same, right? And you know what I mean by the gifts of the Spirit. I mean a whole variety of things. There's those spiritual gifts that are about empowered service. Apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers, they're not all the same thing. They are given to different people. What are you? I want to know where our evangelists are. Prophets. Yeah. Who's dancing through life with Jesus, you know, with those gifts? And not just those, but, you know, community. I meant that's community leadership. But empowered service, you know, hospitality. Mercy, giving. I showed up in my hotel room yesterday with a basket of food that Jesus would have loved. He'd have saved him a miracle with those 5,000. Thank you. I'm so blessed. Giving helps. Gifts of inspired speech. You know these things? Gifts of knowledge, of wisdom. You know, when we talk to people and share with people and the Lord uses one another to speak into one another's lives, words that could change our lives forever, you know, because he knows. Do you know what I'm talking about? Kingdom signs. Where's the miracle man? Gifts of healing. You know. How many of you here are going to raise the dead? How many of you here are going to heal the sick? How many of you here, you know, are going to have the gift of miraculous faith that defies every reasonable bone in your body? And maybe for you and maybe for somebody else, you know, to do what God is calling us to do. I have found that meeting in fellowship where we share spiritual conversation with one another, you know, can be a great way to begin to seek God for these things, to begin to understand what they are, and even to begin to exercise those things. A very small group of people that you trust, you know. These bands can be spiritual conversation can be a place where we discern our gifts, where we use them. You know, in the bands that I'm in, we encourage one another. We say, you know what, if God wants to use you to speak a word of knowledge or insight or prophecy, you believe that you are being given a gift of healing for someone in this group, as we meet together, let us covenant that we'll do it. We will falteringly, hesitatingly say, you know, I sense maybe God is wanting to say this, use me to do that, you know. And there is a safe space where we begin to exercise those gifts. And maybe we're right, maybe we're wrong, but here's the thing. We do not want to miss what God might want to do. Here's how we learn. It's a training ground, you know. And not just for what happens in that, but then, you know, for other spheres of relationship that we might be in to exercise these gifts. We exhort one another to grow in our working relationship with the Spirit. But, you know, we also need to help one another confront our practical secessionism. So, I'm not going to put you on the spot, but just think about this. I'm going to ask a question. You know, you don't have to put your hand up or anything, but, you know, do you believe that God still gives those gifts to people today? Do you believe that God still does those things through you and I today? If you may not. If you don't, then you may well be a theological positionist that says, you know, it all died out with the first apostles. It was not for us, just for them. But let me assume for a minute, for those of you that aren't in that place, but do believe that God does that stuff. Here's my question. It's not whether you actually believe that God can do. Do you actually believe that he does do that stuff? And that he will do it through you? Because the truth is, it's easy to be not a secessionist in principle, but we so often live like secessionists in practice. When the opportunities come to offer words, to exercise gifts, to do things, we don't. Or it might be that not because we might resist it, it might just be the last thing on our minds. How do we live as actual, you know, followers of Jesus who do the things that he did and even greater things? I found these groups. And it's not about doing things. Let me just make a quick distinction here. It's not about whether we are doing things for God. You know, around the campus of Asbury Seminary this last week, I noticed they've been there for ages actually, but there are big banners that say attempt something big for God. And I want to say, amen. You know, why do we stop talking about a great big God with children? We sing the, maybe I'm just confessing here, you know, it's what I see where I am a lot. And stop believing that he's a great big God when we grow up. So, you know, for me, the poster's great. Attempt something big for God. But then there's a little bit part of me that has been around a long time and thinks there's something dangerous in that. But I think what's dangerous about it is not how big the thing is or believing that God can do it. It's that I think what we need, I think the poster would read better, do something big with God. Because we the temptations of Pelagianism, you know, of work, doing things in our own strength, are so massive. We have to keep. I do this all the time. Whenever I get stressed about everything coming up, like coming to Kansas to do lectures, you know, that frighten the living daylights out of me because I'm an introvert by nature. They surprise you. I can barely eat today, right? That actually, it's not my diary is not about what I have to do for God, you know. It's an invitation to do stuff with him. In his, now that's the difference, you know, between religious duty and the joy of missional engagement, you know. Doing the invitation to do things with him. And the experience of that. It's all the difference between the early Methodist preachers. I read all the early Methodist preachers' biographies and autobiographies. I'll say all of them, a good chunk of them, for some research that I was doing. And there was this one guy, he was giving some advice to a young preacher. And he said to the preacher, seek not so much for the art of preaching, but for the anointing of a preacher. No. If you have the art, you will please. If you have the anointing, you will save. Now, it's not a false opposition. You know, let's have art. But we need the anointing to go with the art. And of course, all that means is that we become co-workers with the Spirit in that gift. And then apply that to whatever. Seek not simply the art of hospitality, but the anointing of it, you know. Don't just put food on it in a basket in a room, put a note there that says, you know, we're really, really glad to have you. And I can tell by the way it's written that it's meant. And immediately, a lot of those fears that I brought about coming here and doing this stuff, you know. Well, that was the first one. we'll move a bit quicker. Using disciplines. My question on this is, missional question is, how do we become, you know, if mission is about seeing what the Father is doing, and by the way, I should have said earlier, theologically, what Jesus really tells us that what he's modeling in relation to following his Father is what we need to do in relation to following him, and is what we should, what we are able to do through the gift of the Spirit. So he says, when the Spirit comes, he will teach you what, remind you what I have said, and will guide you into all things. That doesn't just mean stuck in a room doing Bible study. It means when you are faced with having to do something, and you're not sitting there with an ethics class at the back of your head saying, what would Jesus do? The Holy Spirit is actually prompting you to remember and do what Jesus would do. Right? He said the Holy Spirit would come and do that. And it would also, when you find yourselves in those tight spots and you don't know what to say, the Holy Spirit will give you the words to say. I only do what I hear the Spirit of Jesus saying. You know, it's the same thing. We are to live into what he knew with his Father. How do we become more attentive to the presence and the work of God? Wesley has this theology. He says that we all have spiritual senses, right? We just as we have physical senses of the five senses, right? Of sight and hearing and smell and taste and touch, we have analogous spiritual senses. Those physical senses enable us to interact with the physical world around us, you know. But we have these spiritual senses which help us live in the kingdom of God, the spiritual world, if you like, which penetrates and surrounds us all the time. I'm beginning to sound like an episode of Star Wars now, but you know, we had it first. You know, the kingdom of God is here and is in all things and around us, right? You know that, right? It's a realm that we inhabit as we sit here. We sit in the kingdom of God, right? The kingdom of God is all around, coming down. Sounds like a Stephen Curtis Chapman song. Coming down all around, you know. And how do we see that? Maybe that's what Jesus was seeing, you know, the kingdom coming with the blind man, with the leper, whatever it is, right? Wesley would say that we need, well, with Paul, we need to pray, open the eyes of my heart. You know, open the eyes of my heart. Open my spiritual eyes to see. Open my spiritual ears to hear. Open my spiritual nose to smell. To touch, to taste. Is this biblical? Well, I've already tipped you off with the Paul in Ephesians, right? Open the eyes of my heart. What about spiritual sense of taste? Taste and see that God is good. Smell? The fragrance of Christ. It's presence, you know. Yeah. Touch, feel, you know, we feel the presence of God, and his grace and his power is tangible, you know. This is biblical. This is the understanding. Now, it's how we dwell in the kingdom. Prayer is how we open our eyes to see God's presence. Really, it's not just intercession. Scripture is not just reading more, you know, about God, more text. Scripture as a means of grace. Wesley understood as having a living conversation with the Word of God. You know, the Scripture speaks. That's not just a metaphor for kind of, you know, understanding the word, it is that we hear the voice of the Spirit speaking that word over our circumstance. It's not just about what God has said, it's about what God is saying to us. Missional fasting. I wish we had time to talk about fasting. You know, saying no to the addictions of our life and opening our mouths for the fullness of God's feeding. You know, doesn't it say in Psalm, is it Psalm 80 something? Open your mouth and I will fill it. You know, it's that imagery of a child, you know, when you a spoon coming up. You know. Unless they don't like it, then it's. You know. But anyway, and service. Open our hearts, Lord, to feel your passion for the least and the lost. To have your heart for the least and the lost. Sometimes I think we just don't serve because we really just don't care enough. Developing attentiveness to God, again, in these small groups, I found that as we share this walk, this journey together, we help one another long for a closer walk and to abide more deeply in his presence. And to be more attentive, you know, to the heart of God for our neighbours. And we confront one another with the things that hold us back from that. You know, the biggest problem that we've got are not major sins in our life or major moral failures. I mean, they may be issues, but that's not the biggest challenge we face. The biggest challenge we face is so much more subtle than that. It's what Wesley would call dissipation. It is, we are distracted all the time by so many things. And our world and our life gets only ever more distracting. Or maybe that's just me getting older. You know, all sorts of things. Wesley describes dissipation. He says it's about being unhinged from God. Have you ever felt unhinged? No, uncentered. Jesus be the center, you know, of my life, my heart, my everything. How many of you are atheists? You wouldn't admit it even if you were, would you? Another thing that I learned from Wesley, this is like the question about secessionism, right? An atheist, for Wesley, an atheist, and actually again from Ephesians 2, I think, you know, is someone who lives without God in the world. That's the Ephesians text, right? An atheist is not someone who simply doesn't believe that God exists. An atheist is someone who lives like they don't believe God exists, you know. Or God doesn't exist, right? Or to put it another way, an atheist is really someone who lives as though the reality of God's presence and power, his forgiveness and love, is actually irrelevant because they just do life like everybody else. They're like the guy that walks out of the house on the morning after looking at themselves in the mirror, right? He would call it practical atheism. We are not atheists in principle, but actually, we are atheists in practice. How do we help one another, as Wesley would put it, cease to be habitually inattentive to the presence of God? And to walk moment by moment and day by day with an abiding sense of his presence. You know, it's not that you're always in a state of rapture, that's not it. You know, it's just that abiding knowledge, that abiding perception, sense. I've got time for a story, I think. I was my wife and I were going to Canada. I know it's not to be recommended, but we went. Any Canadians in the room? Sorry, apologies. Didn't, that was horrible. But we were going for a wedding, and we were advised to go and look around, have a look around Toronto. And the place that we really needed to go was the CN Tower. You know, if you go up the CN Tower, you get the best views of everything, you know, in the surrounding area. So long as it's not cloudy. Okay? So, we go to Toronto and we walk around and we get to the CN Tower and guess what? It was cloudy. So we walked around for a little bit and tried not to be too disheartened, came back and the cloud dispersed and we went up the tower. Have you, anybody been up the CN Tower? Yeah, it's really beautiful. It's a bit scary because I remember it had like a glass floor around the viewing area. So you're kind of like walking around looking down this horrific drop, you know, and just hoping, you know, I've seen one too many episodes of Raiders of the Lost Ark to hope, you know, that it actually really is glass there. But anyway, you know what? We got up there and my heart sank. I'll tell you why my heart sank. Because the whole of it's like a, you know, the CN Tower, it's got like a circular donut viewing thing around a central tower, for those that have no idea what I'm talking about. And all around this viewing platform was wire mesh. I guess, I mean, it was glass, as I remember still, but then there was wire. I guess to stop people, you know, from throwing themselves off or finding ways to do it or something like that. But my heart sank. Because I saw this and I thought, how am I going to get those beautiful pictures for Facebook that I need with all this wire mesh everywhere? Actually, this was before Facebook. I thought, you know what? I'm here. I'm going to take the pictures. So I just took them anyway. Click, 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 click. Well, when I got home, now, this is going to be totally irrelevant to the vast majority of you youngsters in the room. But when I got home, I opened my camera and took the film out. You've seen those in the museums, right? You know, took the 35mm film out. There's a reason for this. So the 35mm film out. And what we used to have to do, it's really curious for y'all, what we used to have to do is like put that film in an envelope, send it off to a processing lab. They would process it and print out the prints and then send you the prints back and it would come thud on your doorstep. And it was all exciting, you know, a week later. You know, that you've got your prints, right, of these pictures. Wow, things have changed, haven't they? I know. But actually, again, that this has stuck with me because I sort of picked that package up and opened it ready for disappointment, you know, ready for pictures of wire mesh. What I actually discovered was there was no wire mesh. It was just one beautiful image of the scenery that was taking after another, and I was astonished. And I was actually a lay pastor at the time in a particular church where there was a professor of optometry or something like that, and I was telling him this, and he said, "Oh yeah, that's perfectly explainable. You see, the optics of the camera. What you had done, you'd put it like on infinity, right? So what happened is that the depth of field has essentially blurred out." Right, the wire mesh, which was just right here, and it was essentially just so, you know, the optics, you can account for it with the optics, that's all you get. The camera, you might have been focusing on the mesh, but the camera was focusing on the scenery, right? And ever since then I thought, that could be a metaphor for my spiritual life. You know, I walk in the presence of such beauty every day, behind everything, you know, in everything, through everything. But oh, how it is that my sight is so often fixed on the thing that's going wrong, the thing that's not happening my way, the problem that I've got. And it's so, you know, I am actually short-sighted. risking contact lenses today, you know, we're so short-sighted. I fixate on all of these things, on my circumstances, and miss the glory of God everywhere. Fail to pray without ceasing, to give thanks in all circumstances, you know, because my vision's all screwed up. What if I focus, keep my eyes on Jesus? Let's go where I started. Talk about Jesus. Keep my eyes on Jesus. It's not that the mesh isn't there, but I'm not going to make it an idol anymore. I'm going to let that vision transform my circumstances, not let my circumstances lie like a veil over my eyes to the reality of God's presence and power. That's how Wesley describes sin. It's like a veil that lies over our senses. Our problem is, you know, not that we don't have the capacity to see, it's that we go through life sleepwalking. And we need to be awakened, just in case anybody's fallen asleep after lunch. That's why they call it the Great Awakening. Engaging mission. Question: how do we become more responsive to, you remember I talked about that compassion bit, the spirit moving in our hearts, and how that threefold movement of the Holy Spirit that we saw in Jesus, you know, he sensed, he saw, he was moved in his inner being, and then he went and acted, you know. Again, in the early Methodist preachers, they embody this all the time. They talk about mission and daily discipleship as seeking to follow the moment by moment dictates of the Spirit. That's what they call it, you know. Mm. You know, the Spirit speaks and we seek. And it's not just for professional missionaries, you know. It's when you're at work, whatever it is that you're doing, you know, when in your parenting, with your neighbours, seeing things with the eyes, with our eyes opened, and sensing the movement of the Spirit, and acting consistently with that. Wesley called it seconding the motions of the Spirit. Sounds a bit like a boardroom metaphor, doesn't it? You know, the Spirit suggests something, and we second it, and do it. I like that, actually. Do you know what I'm talking about in your own experience? You know, I have yet to find anyone who is seeking to live and grow as a disciple who does not in their heart, their life, at least from time to time, feel those impulses to do something, to say something. Do you know what I'm talking about? In fact, I'd go as far as to say that the question is never, do we have those impulses of the Spirit guiding us? The real question is, what? Will we notice them? And will we do it? And we're right back to Dallas Willard, right? We know what we need to do. We just do or don't do it. You know, and why might we not? So often when I think about this experience in my own life, you know, I'll be in a certain situation. And like most, well, the problem is, I'll tell you what the problem is. The problem is, human beings are intelligent creatures. That's the problem. Well, most of them are, and to varying extents. But, you know, what I mean by intelligent creatures is, one of the marks of intelligence is that we think ahead about outcomes, right? And so what happens is, in those moments, we start processing. What if, dot, 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 right? What if I What if somebody, comes to you and shares their heart with you, and there's some brokenness involved, and you know that God is, the Spirit is stirring you up to offer a word of comfort, of hope, you know, of love. What if you say something and that person is mortally offended and then will never speak to you for the rest of your life? Worse, you know, might think horrible things about you. What if somebody with real need, you know, in their life, maybe even hungry, comes up to you and you know full well that what you need to do is give them a loaf of bread or meet some need, and you think, oh, I don't know if I do that. What if I do that? And they suddenly think that I'm, you know, condescending them, and they start spreading vicious rumours about me, you know, or worse. It might happen in Wichita, you know, they'll pull out a gun and shoot me, you know. That would never happen here, right? What if? And our minds always go to the worst case scenario, and then we shut it down and we walk on our way, right? But what if our what ifs reversed the trend? What if someone comes to me and I know I have a word to say, and I offer that word of hope and love, and that person says, thank you, I have been waiting to hear that for 10 years. That's happened to me more than once. What if somebody, you know, has a real need, and you do give them that loaf of bread, and you even tell them why, and they're so moved by that act of spontaneous act of generosity and kindness that they start doing the same thing, and you've got a whole movement of, you know, kindness on your hands. What if God is who we say he is? What if we started living like what we say about him is actually true? What if, when we have those movements of the Spirit within us, what if we sense them as invitations? God inviting us to work with him. God inviting us to step into a moment in which the kingdom is going to come and break through in someone's life. What if we actually want to have stories to tell of his amazing power and grace at work in us and through us in the lives of others? And we do that, and we have it, and people are blessed, and the kingdom comes. Again, what I found in my small groups is that they help to bridge that gap, you know, between the impulses and the action and the seeing. And it's not that, and sometimes it's a confession, you know, that I think that I had this opportunity and I just didn't, you know, help me, strengthen me, pray for me, that I will be more faithful. Sometimes it can be, you know, there was this situation and I really don't know whether I should have or not. Because the truth is, we are not called to do absolutely everything that is there. And one of the biggest things for us to ever discern in our life and ministry and so on is not just what is good to be done, but what is ours to be done. Who has trouble saying no? Who has trouble, you know, who has trouble in saying, this is great, this ought to be done, somebody needs to be blessed, but it's somebody else to do it. And maybe you even know who else ought to do it, but maybe not. How do you, you know, discern those things? A guy that I've been in a band meeting for nearly 10 years now, he's a postman, mailman. So now he goes, he's always got another guy with him, you know, and they go delivering mail all the time. And our conversations about it are often, because he's like on the beat with these guys, he's always got the opportunity to be talking about Jesus with these guys, you know. And it's been a really interesting, you know, salt of the earth, these guys that he's working with, really interesting sharing with him. And the previous image that I had there, I'm going to say one of the little metaphors that I like about this, you know, it's not just the impulse thing, it's learning how to slipstream the Holy Spirit. If that metaphor means anything to you, you know, slipstreaming. It's getting in behind letting the one that's a sort of cycling metaphor or drum motoring metaphor, you know, letting the one that's in front do the work, and then you get caught up, you know, in what's happening. How does he slipstream the spirit on his rounds with these other mailmen? We help one another to do that, to recognize the spirit's guidance. And we exhort one another to surrender to the leading and the impulses of the spirit. This is going to be my last little book plug. Have you ever come across a medieval French Jesuit, I think, called Jean-Pierre de Caussade? Great. I was not expecting that to be a forest of hands, shall we say. Jean-Pierre de Caussade wrote a book called The Abandonment to Divine Providence. And his basic theology about the life of discipleship and the growing sensitivity to the Spirit, it's this, you know, when you feel the Spirit moving, just do it. That's it, really simple. Just do it. It's like Nike theology, you know. Just do it. Don't think about it too much. Just do it. He also calls then those moments, he speaks about the sacrament of the present moment. When we're in that moment and the Spirit is moving and we participate in that, it's like a sacramental moment in which the gospel is communicated to others. But we come together to face our fears, our double-mindedness, all those what-ifs, and our hard-heartedness, and help one another not let those things have the last word in our lives. Are you tired of letting fear, double-mindedness, you know, lack of courage have the last word in your life? Find some brothers or sisters to get together to walk with through those things. Just by way of summary there, the sharing fellowship bit, talked about that before. Ultimately, what we seek to do in these small groups is discern those missionary movements of the Spirit so that we can become participants in those, through seeking growth, through engaging mission, through using those spiritual disciplines. And one of the things that we would talk about in the work that we do is what we call the rhythm of discipleship. I was expecting a gasp and an awe at my animation skills here, right? You ready? Affirm me, okay? All right? I actually managed to get that going on an axis there. I was not easy. You're very kind and condescending. in some sense, you might call it like an action reflection kind of thing. But the way that we think about it is this, you know, what we're trying to do is cultivate the practices of spiritual reflection on our lives, to spend some time with God saying, how is it going? You know, where have I been faithful to the leading of the Spirit? Where have I not? In those different areas of life. And then let the Spirit raise up the things that we need to share. Then when we come together, we relate, we share those things. And we converse around those things and pray around those things, seek to discern the movement of the Spirit, and then resolve with one another that how we're going to follow the Spirit in the days to come. And then we respond in our daily life with what we feel the Spirit has said. And then as we respond, we come back to reflect, and then to share, and then to respond. You see, it's a circular process. It is the nature and the purpose of band meeting and missional groupings as a whole when we gather as spiritual friends and guides. Let me give the last word to Charles Wesley. Two are far better than one for counsel or for fight. That should say, how can one be warm alone or serve his God aright. Join we then our hearts and hands, each to love, provoke his friend, right, Hebrews. Run the way of his commands and keep them to the end. I think it's time to break. Let me pray. Come, Holy Spirit. Spirit of Jesus. Lord, giver of life, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified. Come, Holy Spirit, Lord. Will you fill us, transform us, gift us, and guide us? Lord, we want to live ever more faithfully in the flow of your Spirit. We want to live ever more faithfully that way of life that gives us stories to tell of your goodness and grace, to bear witness to the truth that you are risen, you are with us, you have all authority, the kingdom is yours and we are citizens of it. Lord Jesus, as we gather up our thoughts, we know that you have gathered us here and that you would send us out from here. But we also know that you send us out and promise to be with us always, even to the end of the age. And so even in all of this, we are never alone, scattered. We are always with you, and it's always your mission, and it's always your words, and it's always your works. And we get the privilege of tagging along with you, joining you hand in hand, and enjoying the works that you have prepared for us to do, that we might be blessed, that you, Lord, might be blessed, and that the world might be blessed to know that you are real, present, and wonderful, and what we all seek from the depths of our being. Lord, we bless you for all of these things in the mighty name of Jesus.